are now going down the Thames towards London's great docks, which are controlled by the Port of London Authority. The Port of London deals with over one-third of the total overseas trade of the United Kingdom and over one-fifth of the shipping entering. Ahead of us are the Royal Victoria, Royal Albert and King George V docks, which are all joined together with one another and together form the largest chute of dock water in the whole world. Directly ahead is the SS Carmania, the 20,000-ton liner of the Cunard Steamship Company. We are now approaching the dry dock on the west side of the King George V dock. Some idea of the immensity of London's trade with the rest of the world may be gathered from this view showing the large number of boats loading up in the docks. The docks have been left some way behind now, and we are approaching the training ship Exmouth. Nearing the end of our journey, we approach the new ocean passenger landing stage at Tilbury Docks, which was opened in May of the...
Dumpers leapt to it on Leap Year's Day, as it was their last chance to avoid Mr. Neville Chamberlain's 10% duty. On February the 29th, the ports were chock-a-block with foreign produce, crowding into the last hours of Britain's free market. The customs closed at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and at 11 o'clock on the same day, tariffs became the law of the land. These ships, unloading in the Port of London, were lucky in arriving in time, as for 3 days the elements had been on the side of the Chancellor of the Exchequer, and a great gale had been raging in the Channel and North Sea. Quite a number of other cargoes were delayed and turned up as the customs opened for business on March the 1st. Here was a case of an ill wind blowing the countryside.
Thank you.